Well, that's how people become billionaires.
That's right.
They get other people to pay for it.
You are, I think, almost equally known, if you look at any kind of materials about you out there, people almost always talk about your political interests as much as your acting.
Oh, well, do they? Oh, well, that's good.
Is that still a big part of your life, or is it something that...
Yes, I think so. I mean, you know, all of life is politics, really, isn't it? I mean, I think the way you live your life is politics. What you believe in, what you say, the kind of work you do, the kind of friends you have. I think that's all politics.
So is this business one where it's hard to be political or
I think the entertainment industry as an industry is essentially non-political, or I mean, you know, they'll eat at any trough, as it were, and don't care who feeds them. And I mean, artists have always said, well, I don't care who my patron is so long as I'm patronized. And that has got translated into, I don't really care where the money comes so long as we get the money and we can make the movie. And I think that gets sort of down the line, that gets, you know, and you play parts that you wouldn't want to be that person, but you can always justify it and say, well, I've played a total racist, for instance, and but then the whole thing of being an actor is that you have to be able to look inside you and find that part of you. It isn't that I'm not a racist. I mean, there's some part of me that is. There's some part of me that's a murderer. I'm capable of those things, and that's what I believe my job as an actor is, to be able to reveal that part of me, when to serve the role.
Isn't that kind of the pleasure of it, or is it the pleasure for you?
No, that's the pleasure. It's also the challenge, you know, because you don't necessarily want to own that, but it's fun to own it within the protection of the role.
So is that what drew you to acting in the first place?
I'm sorry?
Is that what drew you to acting early on?
What drew me to it early on? No, I think actually I wanted to be a mogul early on when I was about 5 or 6, and I used to write little plays and put them on in the kitchen to amuse my mother and make my sisters and brothers and my friends be in them. And I used to get very annoyed when people wanted to go home for their tea. And I would say, we're doing the play, and stomp my foot, and there'd be kids in tears, you know, wanting to go home. And my mother would say, but it's only a game, darling. And I would say, it's not a game, it's my play. It's my play, you know. So you can see I was in training to be a mogul long before I got interested in acting. And I would never take part in those. I would direct them all and produce them all and say who wore what costumes. And we only had 3 costumes. And so I would apportion them out depending upon how desperate one child was to leave. I would say, well, you can wear the crown and the gypsy costume. How about that? I knew about how to get round an actor.
Even in the beginning. So how did you give up that power?
Well, I mean, I grew out of it, and then there were other things to do. Then I could become an actress. And I actually, when I was a kid, I was very, very shy. Strangely enough, with adults, I was very shy. And I remember my father bought me a watch for my 10th birthday, and I wouldn't wear it because I was afraid somebody would ask me the time and I'd have to talk to them, you know, so that was sort of very pathological. And but then afterwards I started to go to the theater, and I realized early on that they were having a lot more fun up there in the light than I was having sitting down in the dark watching them, you know. So I thought, that's where I want to be.
And theater was really the universe you grew up in, right?
Yes, oh yes. And I mean, Ireland didn't have a film industry then, and the only films were, people would come from England and make films there, but that was way out of our reach and we had nothing to do with that. But the theatre was there for everybody, and you could get in for a shilling and sixpence on a Saturday and sit in the back row of the Gate or the Abbey. And I'm so grateful for that. I'm grateful that we had it, and I'm grateful that it was available to everybody. And there was a great tradition of, even an amateur theatre tradition of play writing, play reading, play performing in Ireland as I was growing up. So, and my mother used to take me to the theatre when she could afford it. And so that was the beginning of it. And then movies were something that sort of came and were shown in big cinemas in the center of the city. We didn't even have multiplexes at that point, you know, on the outskirts. I mean, if you wanted to see the movies, you went into the center of the city. And you went in, And nobody ever went on time, of course. That was never. You went in whenever you felt like it, and you went in. And then, I'm sure this is the way Beckett trained for his writing. You spent the next 20 minutes trying to figure out what had gone before that could possibly lead to that denouement of the plot, and then you watched it, and then you waited, and when the film was over, and in those days you could wait and watch it all over again. Mm-hmm. So you would wait until, you know, you'd say, this is where we came in. No, let's wait. And you see, so you had the pleasure of watching something in the present unfolding before you while working out what had gone before, while anticipating how it might conceivably end. So you see, it was a great intellectual exercise.
Well, shoot, doing film and television acting, I assume you have to do that all the time. Isn't that kind of the exercise?
Yes, quite.
You're never shooting in order, so.
No, you're not. Well, sometimes you are, very rarely, but you're never doing that. But then at least you've had the advantage of reading the script, so you right. know where the story starts. But mm-hmm. my movie going as a kid, you never knew where the story started.
It sounds like it would have been less fun if you had gone on time.
Oh yes, nobody went on time. It was it was sort of a cultural knowing, you know. Who was it who said something about the known unknown? You know, so we were practicing the known, the unknown known, long before it became fashionable to say so.
So you, what was the first time you saw yourself as being somebody who might want to be on that screen?
That was a long time away, because I saw myself only as somebody who would want to be on stage. And it never occurred to me that I would be on screen ever. For the longest time, I think, when was it? Oh yes, Disney went to make a movie in Ireland, which was based upon the diary of a highwayman, and John Hurt played the part of the highwayman. And I got hired to play in that. And it was the Mirisch brothers who produced it. Mm. And John Huston directed it. And it was one of the worst films ever made. In fact, a critic said about it, this film couldn't have opened, it must have escaped. You know, it was just awful.
And that was your first movie you were in?
Yeah, that was the first one. And I was quite disillusioned by that. I thought there was something sort of ridiculous about it. And they had wonderful people like Robert Morley was in it, Maxine Audley, mm-hmm. John Hurt, I think in his very first movie role, and lots of other really distinguished English actors who were in it. And I thought it was all a little bit ridiculous.
So did the experience of making it, was that interesting or fun, or was that just the distraction from the work you were doing on stage?
It was different, but it was, I didn't understand how movie people talked, you know. Mm. And Huston, who was very nice, but he was really sort of a man's man, you know, and he talked to me as though I were a child of five, you know, and tried to explain to me several times what the piece was about. And I'd read the script, so I thought, I think I know what it's about. And. But he was very courteous, and the producer was very nice. And other than that, they left me alone, and I stood in line, played my part, did what was expected of me. It was a very small role, and I had to wear a bonnet, which I did not like. I've never taken to bonnets.
It's your first thing in your contract. Like some people want kind of green M&Ms. Yours is no bonnets and my...
No bonnets, that's
the
right.
The no bonnet or clause.
No bonnet. But it was certainly an experience, which I thought the whole thing was rather ludicrous, you know. And I couldn't believe the time they took, endlessly took, to do anything. You know, I couldn't believe that. When I was used to the theatre where you went in and you worked like a dog, you know, hours and hours and hours, got lots of abuse for it, then had to go on stage and do it night after night, you know. So it seemed to me, but then I was quite snobbish in those days and I didn't know anything about anything, you know.
So what eventually drew you out to Hollywood?
What drew me out here was I had come to New York, come to Broadway. Alex Cohen, the great American producer in New York, had seen me do a Brian Friel play at the Gate in Dublin, and he bought the rights to that, and he invited three of us from the original cast to come out and do it in New York. and he hired Art Carney as the star. And I had never seen Art Carney. I'd never seen The Honeymooners. And so people kept on saying to me, oh, The Honeymooners! And I would say, what are they talking about? But he was a lovely man, lovely actor, very, very talented man. Anyway, that brought me here. And then I met my husband when I was on tour, the man I'm still married to. And we were on tour and I was playing Baltimore and he was at Johns Hopkins. He was a physician. And I met him there, and then eventually, anyway, we got married, and we didn't get married until we came out here. And he was offered a job at UCLA and the VA, and he's a psychiatrist. And I said to him, you know, I can't live in Baltimore. I really can't. I'm not well enough known yet to live wherever I want.
Right.
So I have to live either in New York or London or Dublin even, or Los Angeles. And so then he was offered this job here at the VA and at UCLA, and so okay.
So you came to Hollywood for love?
I came to Hollywood for love, imagine. Yeah.
And then you
And I'm still here for love.
And you're still here. And did you get used to, I mean, LA is a film and television town. There really is very little theater.
Do you know, I didn't do very much theater here, but it was extremely difficult to break into film. When I came here in 72, there wasn't the great, it was very much an American industry. There were American actors working in films, American actors working in television. I think there were very, very few. It hadn't had the huge influx of British actors that happened later, you know, in the late, the 80s, the late 70s, early 80s. That's when that began to happen. But it hadn't had that. And so it was extremely difficult to break into film. Nobody would hire me for a movie. And then I did start to do television and did How the West Was Won, which was, you know, John Mantley hired me for that, and which was a wonderful experience. I got to go places in the United States where I'd never been before and had only read about. And things like that, but it was a very, very difficult. And so actually, my very first film that I, major feature that I did, was an Irish film called Some Mother's Son, which Terry George directed and Jim Sheridan and Terry produced, wrote and produced, and they hired me for that with Helen Mirren. But that was a long time afterwards, so I had done a lot of television here before that happened.
So was that satisfying in any way, or was it just kind of work?
Some of it was, but some of it was dreadful. Some of it was just, you thought, what on earth is this about, you know? And then you would decide, well, it's about nothing. All right, now I know. So, you know, you would do the best you could. And some of the roles were, you thought, all right, I'm speaking on behalf of a voice for people who perhaps don't have a voice, the disenfranchised or the victims or the whatever, you know? And so that was how you could get through it. And then some of them were, and then sometimes I got really lucky and I got to work with good people and got to see how it all worked. And I'm grateful for that, because that was, I think, to work in television here, you need to know how to work fast. You know, there's no time. There's no time to discuss anything. There's no time. I mean, you can't sort of say, oh, you know, what do you think the scene is about? Well, you better know what the scene is about when you hit the floor, you know, and know your lines and get on with it. And very rarely is it different than that.
So you weren't fighting to have more. You kind of understood what the system was and adjusted to it as you had to.
Yes, as one had to, you know. And then I did go back and do theater. I went back and did theater in Ireland, and I did Streetcar Named Desire there. I did the Yates, the Beckett International Festival. I did the Yates International Festival. So I did really, really good theater with good people and good directors, and some original plays. And so I would go and do that, and that was a way of going to the well and remaining sane, you know. And then, of course, and of course, what happens then is, because in a small country like Ireland, which at that time did not have a film industry, they were terrifically impressed with my resume, which consisted of a lot of episodic television, you know, and I wasn't impressed by that at all, you know, but they were. So I was building sort of credibility over there and having no credibility whatsoever here. But nonetheless, I persisted, and then I got lucky, you know.
And is that universe, was that universe as small as it seemed when that all kind of broke, when the Irish wave came after the British wave? You know, Terry and Jim and Neil, and they all seem to kind of know each other and have been in theater together. And
yes, but remember, yes, and they do all know each other. And how that came about, and if you look at it, they all made films there. They didn't sort of come here and make films. They didn't move into Hollywood to make films. Mm. I mean, Terry has made films here, and so has Jim, a couple, but mostly their work grows indigenously from where they are. Mm. And Jim writes from where he is, and so does Neil. And so and of late, he's been doing work over there. That I mean, The Borgias, for instance, is a homegrown, mm-hmm. wonderfully done television series, and but very much grown out of there and grown out of European history. So there's been a distinct divide, I think, between the people who would come here and work and mm-hmm. and work on American product, and the people who would only work out of Ireland. Mm. So fortunately, and I think it's a good thing, the indigenous Irish industry now, film industry, is growing out of those people, and a lot of a crop of young people coming up. And I've been lucky to be included in some of it, to go back and work, you know, with John McDonough and on The Guard, for instance, and work with Brendan, and then touch base and work with people that I've known for years and years and years, mm-hmm. you know. And so that's also a way to give back. Too, because there's some short films, young films that I'm participating in that otherwise wouldn't be able to get made, and that's good.
So did the movie break change everything in terms of the work for you? I mean, did movies give you a chance to do performances that on film that were more interesting overall?
I think yes, I think that's true. And at the same time, a film that I did myself, which grew out of a stage show that I wrote and put together a stage show called James Joyce's Women, and had done that around the world on stage, and that was directed by Burgess Meredith, who was sort of my mentor, and I was very lucky for that. And then Universal gave me the money to make it as a film, and I did. And the experience of doing that and of producing that and of being, I played six roles in it, for God's sake, you know, I mean, it was just, I mean, what I think now, I think I wouldn't take that on. But just the sheer experience of doing it did a wonderful thing for me internally. And that was, it changed me, because after that, I wasn't afraid of anybody anymore. Hmm. And I could get my phone calls answered, even though I wasn't getting hired. And I think because they thought, oh, she only does James Joyce. Oh my God, we couldn't ask her to do, you know, this chicken shit. You know, so I wasn't getting work, but people respected me. But you know, you can die of terminal respect. Yeah. You can. And in a town like this, you can, where people are very generous in their admiration, but oh my God, they don't know what to do with you. Mm-hmm. So that was difficult, but at the same time, I knew what was happening, and I knew too that it had changed, the experience had changed me inside. Mm-hmm. And so I could step up to the plate if invited to do something without being afraid. And, mm-hmm. you know, and I used to fear the moguls and what they would think, and casting directors. I used to fear casting directors' assistants and the receptionist and everybody.
It's an intimidating.
It's all gone now. It doesn't matter.
Acting is not an easy game. It's not an easy business to be in.
No. Of course not. That's why I picked it, of course. I mean, why pick being a bank manager when you could be an actor? You're rejected every day of your life, you know.
So how did Tasting Menu come to you?
That came to me, Roger Gall sent me the script. Mm-hmm. I don't know what he'd seen me in, but he'd seen me in something. And he sent me the script, and he also sent me his first ever movie, which was Smoking Room, mm-hmm. which is brilliant, wonderful. And he won a Goya for that. And the conceit in that is so clever, and the execution is so well done. And the whole, it's a film full of tension and, mm-hmm. and a very simple premise that grows and grows in tension until finally you think, oh my God, someone's going to get killed. And to be able to execute that in 90 minutes, you know, was extraordinary. And mm-hmm. I thought, this guy knows what he's doing. I'd love to work with him. And so when he sent me the script for Tasting Menu, which sort of wandered all over the place, and you thought, how do you bring all these people together, and does food matter that much? And I'm not a foodie, so I couldn't say that, oh, it's about food, you know, because there's no actor on the planet who would say that. You'd say, oh, it's about me, you know, it's about my character, you know, the food, move over, please, you're only a plate of salad or something. So it wasn't the food that kind of brought me in there, but then it was Roger's work, and also he said he was going to shoot it out on the Costa Brava at a place called Empurias Brava, which has to be one of the most beautiful places on the planet. Mm. So what's to say no to?
And is it as fun as it looks? I mean, it seems like it must have been a pretty light, charming set.
Yes,
somehow.
It was absolutely charming. The Catalans are beautiful people, and they're great fun. They're very intense, which I like, because it's great fun. You burst out laughing when they go on and on in their intensity about something that's so trivial, like pass the salt, you know. Getting really worked up about this. And they're great fun, absolutely great fun, terrific crew. I've never seen a crew work so hard, so consistently, and really hard, because we were right there on the beach. You know, we were staying in that hotel. I was staying in that hotel. The crew were in some hole in some local town, but just lovely, willing, hardworking, great fun-loving people. Catalan food is marvelous, and even though that isn't what we were eating in the picture, I mean, the picture was all specially done on, you know, leaves and things, and, you know, inside rock encased things that you had to break open with a hammer, and then of course you'd have to take one little bite, and then they'd take it away because they're going to do another shot, and they had to give you another one.
Start again.
It was a very happy experience, yes.
Was the food they gave you for the shot, was it actually good?
Oh, yes.
Or were they faking it for the camera?
No. That was all done by a master chef who was over there at the side. We shot all the dining room scenes in Barcelona in a studio. And so that was all. He had his own special place over there with all his assistants who were hanging around, like hovering. They taught to hover. They're about this much off the ground, you know, and they're hovering, waiting for him to hand them a plate of marvelous something or other, and then they would bear it away to give to the actor playing the waiter. And he was a master chef, no question. And as I've said before, he handled the food as though it were uranium, you know, and precise and carefully, and, you know, in his own time, and we all waited for that. And then it would arrive, and you think, how on earth do I eat this? Do I prod it? Is it still living? No, should I speak to it first?
Was there specific directions for each item, or were you left to your own devices?
No, there were directions, actually. Yes, you were told, things that came in a sort of encased in a crust, you were given a little hammer, and so you were hope you were going to crack it on the first whack. Otherwise, you'd have to start the scene all over again. And then actors never want to eat on camera. I mean, who wants to be photographed, you know? So you sort of play with your food a lot. And so you play with little bits of this, and then just, can you? Delicious, delicious. And it was delicious, but you couldn't possibly have made a meal of it,
right?
Because it was tasting. It's just, you know, which is a tradition there. It doesn't exist here, I think. No. But, you know, they have the whole tapas bar tradition. So they're used to eating things that are like the size of your fingernail, you know, and saying, oh, this is wonderful. Oh, this is so wonderful. And you just have to go with that.
Here the tapas portions are larger, and there are 38 plates at every table.
That's right.
Because we need
big
portions here in America.
That's right. That's right.
That's where we're also giant.
That's right. But, you know, apart from that, Roger Gall, who directed the film and wrote it, is a wonderful cook. He's a wonderful cook himself. And he cooked an incredible meal for us. He cooked a paella one night on the beach for the whole crew, for the whole company. And we had a big party, and it was marvelous. And I said to him, listen, if art ever fails, open a restaurant, you know, this is wonderful. And the whole local food is great. And then some of the actors took me to, when we went to Barcelona, took me to some of the barrio restaurants where you just eat what they're making, you know. You don't order, especially from a menu. You say, yeah, I'm hungry, and they bring you what they've cooked that night. And that's great.
It sounds like there should be a sequel for you.
I think there should be a sequel, yes.
Just to go back to do all this again.
Oh, I would go back in a heartbeat.
So what is it, I mean, so at this point you are an esteemed veteran. What's the right word to look for it? You're, I mean, because you are kind of revered and you are seen in a certain place. Yeah, I think so. You bring a weight to things, which is, I think, why they wanted you in the movie in particular, besides your brilliant acting.
Thank you.
You kind of naturally carry that. What gets you out of the house now? Is there specific things you look for when a script comes by, or?
Yes, I always look at the script. If it isn't on the page, you're never going to find it in the ether around you, you know. Mm. And I think that what's on the page is so important, and I love writing. I mean, I when I'm very happy, I write a little bit, and I enjoy that so much. And I love writers, you know. I mean, they're now, you know, Gabriel Garcia Marquez just died, and I mean, a light has gone out of the world. How can he be replaced? No one could replace him. His influence was enormous, and I've been fortunate to be brought up on books, you know, long before television, and we had the radio, which is a great training, mind you. The radio is a great training because you have to exercise your imagination. And that's what you need as an actor. You have to imagine. I mean, sometimes you're working with someone and you think, what am I working with? Is this like a cheese sandwich or what? So you have to imagine that there's somebody else, that they are. You've got to see through the eyes and into that other character that they're hiding back there. Mm. And I'm sure I've done that myself. I'm sure I've, you know, blocked off what's available. And I'm sorry about that. I take this opportunity to apologize to actors I've worked with if I've ever done that to you. So you do learn, I've forgotten what you asked me. I've forgotten the question.
What was just that the thing that draws you to work?
Always the script, always the script. Always the script.
And are you particularly interested in your character, or are you interested in the whole mass of it, or?
Well, I'm interested in what the story has to say. I mean, it's wonderful to work on something that has something to say that matters. You get to do an awful lot of good stories, but about things that don't really matter. Mm-hmm. And for instance, Some Mother's Son mattered. It was about something that mattered in our history, a watershed in Irish history, the hunger strike in the Mays prison in the 1980s, and what happened as a result in Irish families. And that mattered. To me, it mattered, and I think it mattered to the audience who bothered to come see the film, and I think the Trans-America was a picture that mattered. It was about something that's important, the treatment of transgender people by us, you know, and what we don't do to prevent the horrible things that are done to them. And I thought Felicity was wonderful. Felicity Huffman was wonderful in that role. And I think Duncan Tucker, who made it was his first time out of the box as a director, and he had written it. And I thought this was certainly a picture that mattered and that should be done. Mm-hmm. And so I thought that my part in it, although I didn't like my character particularly, but I had great relish in playing her because she was someone who did not understand what was going on. Mm-hmm. And I've met a lot of people who don't understand what's going on, and I feel sorry for them. So I could play her with a certain amount of empathy, I think. And so those kinds of things, when that's on the page and it's a piece that is about something, and then there are times when you just do it because you've got a mortgage to pay and it pays well and they're going to treat you well, and you know, you do it. And then there are things that are just so damn strange and mysterious, like Lost, you know? Fish's idea why I did that. But I had no idea what she was about, but people liked it. Mm-hmm. And it fitted into this very strange saga of a story. She was the only character who knew both the past and the future. So, you know, you could come out of anything could come out of your mouth and you could justify it. Yeah.
So is it fun to just go to work sometimes when you're just doing it because you know?
Oh, yes. It's great fun to go to work. And I did this sci-fi thing in Canada for the first season of I've forgotten what the show is called. Defiance. Mm-hmm. Defiance is what it's called. And I did the first season of that. And that was so strange because it was so sci-fi. I'd never done sci-fi before. And so I had to keep on believing oh, this is the future. This happens in the future. But then I did Star Trek years ago. I'm Data's mom. I mean, a little respect now.
I know.
Data's mom. And I went home at the end of that and I said to my husband, well, I can retire now. I've been beamed up.
And do you go to Trek? Do you get Trek people stopping you on the street?
Yes, I
say hi still.
Yes, people do. People do, and remember that. And then I was asked when I was doing a play in Galway a few years ago, and it was in this tiny little theatre. It was a new play, and it was one of these plays where people either were weeping copiously in the audience or howling with laughter. You know, it was all about a dysfunctional family, and people identified, so they were either weeping because that was them up there, or their family, or they, so it was their family, and they just couldn't believe that anyone could reproduce it. So that's the kind of audience we had. And then I got a call from the local, the secretary of the local Trekkie Society, to say, would I come and talk to them? And I said, well, where are you? And they were a bit outside town. And so I said, well, how many of you are there? And he said there were 19 of them. So I said, well, why don't you come to the play? I'll get you seats and you come to the play and we'll meet afterwards. And they came to the play and they all sat in the front row and they never laughed or cracked a smile or shed a tear the whole time. And no matter what else was happening on stage, they were riveted on me. I could have eaten the phone book and they would never have taken their eyes off me. No matter what anybody else did or said, they never moved their eyes off me. And so it was a very strange, and I could see them because it was just like they were as close as you are to me, right? And so we met afterwards and we talked about Star Trek. And I realized after about 5 minutes that really all they wanted was to have their picture taken with me and to sign autograph books. And they weren't really interested in anything else I had to say. And not that I got a chance to say much of else. And they were very quiet. And I have never seen such respectful people, honestly. And so I signed everything and we all got photographed together and separately, singly, one after the other, and then all together several times. And the stage manager did all of that. And then we all shook hands and bid them good night, and they trooped off into the night.
Just like the HFPA.
Just like?
The Hollywood Foreign Press. It's the same kind of thing.
Is it really?
Yes, they all take pictures with the talent, and they all, you know, then they disappear to the next press conference somewhere,
oh,
pay dinner or whatever
sakes.
They're doing.
Oh, well, bless their hearts, you know.
So these years later, after starting in the kitchen, directing shows, has the journey been what you expected, or did you have expectations?
It was really very, my expectations when I was a child and when I was a kid were, you know, were very sort of strange. I didn't understand film or the movies because that was something that was made elsewhere, far away and full of people whom I would never meet and who spoke in, if they were English films, they all spoke in clipped voices like that. And they, when they wanted to make love, they all wore paisley dressing gowns, you know. And then there were cowboy movies, you know. And you went to the movies late, as I've told you, and waited for it to come round. And so cowboy movies you went to and you sat there and you were definitely on the side of the Indians. Definitely. Because the rest of them were so stupid. You thought, first of all, look at them. They don't even know that there are people waiting for them over the hill. You know, where have you been? So everything was reduced to the games we used to play as children. You used native intelligence and you knew there was someone waiting for you around the corner, hidden, you know, in your back garden, right? You always knew that. That was part of the thrill. You'd go seeking them out and they'd pounce on you. And so I could never understand it as a child and as a teenager that in the movies they didn't twig that, you know, they rode right into the danger. And that was because my sense of heroics was different to Hollywood. And it still is.
So once you became an actor, did the your vision of what your career, after you got off the theater, you've done some film, maybe you come to LA, has that number of years been as you thought it might be, or has it been, have you gotten out of acting what you were hoping to get?
I'm not sure. There are parts that I like to play, like to have a whack at, but you know, now I'm writing a little bit, and that makes me so happy. I like doing that, and I like to direct, and so that's, I think that's probably going to be a door I'm going to walk through. Of course, I'll have to kick it down, first of all, you know, and I'm practicing doing that right now. And but I thought, has it been what I expected? I don't know. I never think about that, really. I don't think I came with expectations of what it would be, and I've been eternally surprised. You know, I'm always surprised that people remember that I was in something. You know, because I don't. Oftentimes there are things I've think, oh, that's right, I was in that. Yeah. I saw John Turturro's picture on the paper the other day, and I said, oh, I worked with him.
Yeah. I know that guy.
He's doing all right. You know, so nice things like that happen that I think have to do with lack of expectation. Mm. Yeah.
Just do the work.
Just the work, you know, the work. And it's very nice to work. I mean, I do so love it. I love to, when it's the right part, I love to do it. And then when it's the wrong part, I think, serve you right, Fionnula. You knew from the beginning that this was the wrong part. You should have said no.